come to worship today, we will reflect on God's spiritual fruit of gentleness. So for our friends who are visiting, we're going through all 9 fruits of the Spirit this summer. So we're on number 8, which is the spiritual fruit of gentleness. And you can find these in, they're given to us by the Apostle Paul in the 5th chapter of Galatians. So we are looking at the 5th chapter of Galatians in minute detail all summer long. So what about gentleness? Sometimes gentleness just doesn't seem like a spiritual fruit. Sometimes gentleness might look like cowardice. So today we're going to consider the difference between being so humble that we become a punching bag and the humbleness of God, God's self, who allows us to spurn and reject him, yet who always looks for us to return back to him, looking for forgiveness, for reconciliation, and for comfort. So let us consider this difference between our secular idea of gentleness and godly gentleness. As we settle our hearts and minds in the prelude by our music director, Susan Ramirez.
Thank you.
our liturgy. Every week, we practice confessing our sins before God and one another. Holy and merciful God, we confess to you and to one another, we have sinned by our own fault in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. And when we are frustrated by the violent way we get things done.
This week, we remember that Jesus calls us to be meek, humble, and gentle with one another. The first way of gentleness is to not leap to hasty judgment.
Help us to listen first and try to understand.
The second way of gentleness is to wait before we take offense.
Help us breathe deeply to loosen the ties of our anger. Help us work through our desire to take revenge, punish, and hurt one another.
The third way of gentleness is to allow ourselves to feel wounded.
To change requires courage, and courage requires risk. Jesus courageously took risks, and as Jesus was hurt, we will be hurt. Help us not live simply to avoid risk and hurt, but to turn to you, O Lord, for help. So let us pray together. May your Spirit fill us with courage to remain hopeful and not despair. Strengthen us and guide our actions that we may truly bear good fruit. Jesus called a child whom he put among them and said,
Truly I tell you, unless you change and become like children, you will never enter the kingdom of heaven. Whoever becomes humble like this child is the greatest in the kingdom of heaven. Whoever becomes humble like this child is the greatest in the kingdom of heaven. Whoever welcomes one such child in my name welcomes me. Jesus continued to teach them, if any of you put a stumbling block before one of these little ones who believe in me, it would be better for you if a great millstone were fastened around your neck and you were drowned in the depth of the sea. Woe to the world because of stumbling blocks. Occasions for stumbling are bound to come, but woe to the one by whom the stumbling block comes. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
And she teaches her child song to the
rapture, when the child does something wonderful, or grows or becomes an adult in the rites of puberty, they sing this song of the child, the special song that belongs only to that person, which is a way of honoring her. But if at any time during their life this person commits a crime or unethical social act, the individual is called once again into the center of the village, and the whole community form a circle around that person and sing their song to him or her. The correction for antisocial behavior in this tribe is not, first of all, punishment. It is love and being reminded of our original identity. The idea is when you recognize your own song, you have no desire or need to do anything that would hurt another person who is as precious as you are. That is a truly gentle process of repair and reconciliation, and I think Paul would love it. But as Christians, we have developed our own ritual of repair when we lose our way. We call it confession. And as Pat explained, our liturgy teaches us every week to take the law out of our own eye through confession and to acknowledge that we are biased and we make mistakes and we hurt people even when we don't mean to. We believe as Christians that it is okay to make mistakes. And we have the story of Adam and Eve at the very beginning of the Bible. Without whom, if they hadn't made those mistakes, we wouldn't have the whole Bible. It's all about learning how to grow up into wisdom, into our destiny, the destiny that God is calling us. And God has created us in that mystery, in that destiny. We can make mistakes because, as Jesus says in today's reading, unless you change, and that word literally means turn from the realm of the flesh into the realm of the spirit, you won't enter God's kingdom. In today's reading, the change that Jesus is asking us for is to become humble. And that means literally in Greek to lower our status. So the Greeks are very status focused. The slaves are at the bottom. And that's where Jesus keeps turning us all to the bottom of all the echelon. So when we make mistakes, we feel wounded and vulnerable, and we hate that. But Jesus says we must allow ourselves to make mistakes. We must allow our pride to be wounded, or else we won't learn and grow in our spirits. If we are not humble, if we don't accept the wounds and the pains of learning, of being wrong, of hurting someone even when we didn't intend to hurt him or her, then our spiritual growth will be stunted. So I have an illustration, and it comes from my own body. This last December, I fell on the ice, squarely, straight down, a right angle, right onto my patella. I probably fractured it, but I blew it off. And for 6 months, I ignored it, and I planned on it just getting better, like most things in my physical health seem to do. I didn't want to admit that I was hurt and I needed therapy. And in reaction to the injury, scar tissue formed in my knee so that it liked being bent and it didn't want to unbend. And the leg froze and I couldn't strengthen it, and then it weakened. It became encased exactly as it was injured. For me, the turning point came when I acknowledged I was hurt, and several of our congregation helped me acknowledge that. It wasn't getting better, it was getting worse. And they said, we've gone to physical therapy. Here's the number. So I didn't want to, but I listened. And perhaps the hardest and most challenging part of the therapy I've been receiving is when they put that warm compress on and the pain just leaches out and I feel like crying, even though it didn't really bother me, but I walked in. Acknowledging the hurt is awful. My poor tissues. So I've learned through this process that new growth comes from undoing the injury. So I thought I needed to bend my knee a lot, and I was wrong. What I needed to do was to practice straightening my leg. And I've been doing that for months. My knee example shows that the opposite of gentleness is hard. When we are wounded spiritually, say someone hurts us, sometimes we have to be hardened.
Perpetrating more harm,
because we haven't healed that original wound. Sadly, more and more young adults are choosing a path of estrangement from their own parents. So as they grow up into adulthood, they are abandoning their parents instead of trying to heal themselves and heal their relationships. This is a calling for the Christian church to help families come back together. Help wounded children heal their wounds and then help them reach out to their vulnerable parents. Like my 6-month swollen knee, we have a bad habit of not dealing with and healing our own wounds. We don't value them. Instead, as Paul warns, we displace our hurt in anger. Anger, revenge, punishment, estrangement, abandonment, all of these things are stumbling blocks to reconciliation and repair of relationships. And what does Jesus say about us creating stumbling blocks, scar tissue, that keep people from experiencing God's full love? Jesus' words are some of the harshest I've ever heard anywhere. If any of you put a stumbling block before one of these little ones who believe in me, it would be better for you if a great millstone were fastened around your neck and you were drowned in the depth of the sea. Pat said today she just couldn't believe these words came from Jesus' mouth. But that's how serious Jesus is about us stopping the process, that purely normal process that goes on in our natural world of hurt upon hurt upon hurt. Our job is to help the world heal and to undo those wounds. Gentleness is the spiritual gift of not creating or undoing a stumbling block. Gentleness is the spiritual gift of waiting and not taking offense in a knee-jerk reaction. In our neuroscience book that we were reading as a group about the fruit of the Spirit has some suggestions for us about how we can approach problems with a spirit of gentleness. If we are to resolve problems instead of making them bigger, we must get ourselves ready to listen deep. But we can't listen to another person deeply until the spiritual fruit of gentleness urges us to work and consider our own wounds in our own selves. We have to heal ourselves. And that means in the church we have to help each other heal. And then, when we are on our own path, acknowledging our own woundedness, then we can start to listen to other people and be curious about them. Only when we have processed our feelings can we make ourselves available to listen to the people who are threatening our peace. So they're mad at us for some reason, but we just want to create a barrier against them to protect ourselves. If we work on our own woundedness, we can take down a bit of that barrier and listen. While we are listening, we can try to build rapport by repeating our discussion partner's words. So our first tendency is to say, no, that's not true, I'm not listening to that. But the harder thing to do is to listen and to find out what that person, the depth of what they truly feel, and the emotions that are lying under the surface. We can help summarize what we hear, and so that the person knows that they're being heard. And we can ask open-ended questions that invite the person to explore their own woundedness. Because that has to happen on both sides. That person has been wounded, that's why they're acting in anger, and they need to acknowledge their own woundedness. And we can hold a mirror up and say, I see you are very angry, where is that coming from? It's a little bit like putting a compress around my knee and letting the anger and the hurt come out. Deep listening is the first step to being open to forgiveness. Deep listening to another who is willing to share their pain can help us be more willing to be vulnerable. And vulnerability, leaving ourselves open to being wounded, is something most of us weren't taught as a spiritual value. Yet we have the example of Jesus who showed us that he chose a path of no holds barred vulnerability in his public and shameful execution. Surely we are not ashamed of Jesus on the cross, and we cannot be ashamed when we ourselves feel hurt. Jesus was telling us that the only way out of the world of evil, self-serving greed and violence and people always looking for one-upmanship is a way that risks vulnerability. Any group, even a church group, needs to be able to investigate and overcome our weaknesses in safe ways. And unless we do, those weaknesses remain unspoken. Those wounds stay, and they have force. Jesus encourages us all to give up our pride, which is standing in our way, and to assume the humility of a humble child. We may be scared to take this risk, and many people spend a good part of their lives ensuring they will be as invulnerable as possible. They're always looking for ways of increasing their security and their insurance against disaster. The problem is that we cannot grow in our spirits if we are spending all our time doing we don't risk falling sometimes and hurting our knees, we will never spiritually thrive into the full growth of ourselves as children of God. Learning from vulnerability, mistakes, and wounds is in fact the path to infinitely more lively lives, richer lives, fuller lives. Because we have a Savior who went before us, we know that no matter how much we have been hurt, we will never be alone. And as God, through our Christian community, will always restore us back to full grace in God. And in the repair, we will each become stronger. Yes! And wiser. And we will always become more loving. As the birds are loving each other, okay? And I hope they find their way out. Maybe we can open up a back or something for them, for survival. So pray with me. Jesus, our pride and our preconceived judgments become stumbling blocks for us and for the people we love, and they get in our way. Lord, we know that they make us hostile and competitive and callous and unable to hear one another. All these habits prevent the truth, your truth, from being heard. Encourage us, Lord, to be vulnerable together and to create a safe space in our church and in our families where all people can make mistakes and learn and grow and thrive in your love.
Thank you.
resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Now may you please be seated.
Seek us out, and for your humble grace, we sing your praises.
Friends, please consider in silence the needs and thanksgivings that are laid on your heart, making your heart sing with joy and with silence.
Let us join all these prayers together through Jesus Christ our Lord.